Welcome back to The Checkpoint. My name is Vivian Kamsimi, and today we have the ambassador of the United Nations representing Uganda, a permanent representative of Uganda at the United Nations. And we are wondering, what does it mean for Uganda to host the NAM Summit, the Non-Aligned Movement Summit, and the G77 plus China summits that will be coming up next week? Now, Ambassador, what agenda are we expecting in the NAM summit and the G77 summit, and how are they different?
It's a very full agenda. First of all, you have the official summit program, then you have side events. Let me start with the full agenda of the summit, which really begins on the 15th, which is Monday, 15th January, with the senior officials meeting, and ends on 16th. The senior officials meeting basically work, negotiate all the outcome documents that will be endorsed by ministers and then by the presidents. So they really do the heavy lifting of the summit. And then you have on 17th and 18th, you have ministers meeting. Then 19th and 20th, you have heads of states. And then, of course, the G77 is 21st and 22nd. Heads of states, there is no ministerial meeting. But there is officials meeting on the 18th to prepare for the G77 summit. So those are the official programs. Then you have side events. You have UNCTAD, it's a UN agencies. A UN agency that deals with trade and environment issues. They will host a side event on the sidelines to deal with issues of development and trade. There are a lot of speakers, very, very prominent speakers that will be speaking. They will be joined by some heads of states on the sidelines in Munyonyo. Then there is the South Center. South Center is a think tank that really started with NAM and G77. They will also have a side event in Munyonyo. Then you have a business summit that will take place from Monday also to 18th of January. That is really very important for Uganda. We've really got, it's sold out. We've got a lot of attendance from the investment agencies in East Africa, but also chambers of commerce from NAM member states that are really doing economically well in the Middle East and in Asia, that are coming to really, you know, pair up and collaborate with our investment authorities in the region. You see, we have made it East Africa. So all these investment agencies in East Africa will do their pitch in that summit. Each one will have a day. And then that meeting will be closed by His Excellency the President. And we hope to attract over $800 million in such engagements, because these are huge companies, these are huge opportunities. Then we have another meeting of women in agriculture. On the night taking place at Serena Chigo. That will really, you know, agriculture is one of the underrated sectors in Uganda, in Africa, and the role of women in the agricultural sector is key. And there will be a discussion organized by the Minister of Agriculture and UNDP to really deal with that issue, and also great speakers. So those are really that's the program in short.
Okay. Ambassador, tell us about the member states of NAM, who we are expecting here. And we know that some of these member states are so powerful. Indonesia has developed so much that they've left us as a country, Uganda. We've also seen countries like India. Now India summons African meetings to their country to discuss economics, business, for the different African countries. What does it speak into these member states, you know, like from the time they were coming together to form the NAM, and now that they still find this kind of pact or the non-aligned movement important to them?
I mean, you see, the developing countries across the region have one philosophy and one one philosophy really and policy of solidarity. You know, these Asian countries have done well, but they know where they came from. And they really, you know, want to really make sure that through what we call South-South cooperation, really cooperate and it becomes a win-win for all of us. And that's why you find, I mean, India is well developed, but it still have pockets of poverty as well. So we can learn and benefit from them, but they can also learn and benefit from us. And many, many other NAM countries that have done well economically. We all learn from each other in the spirit of solidarity, not in the spirit of competition or of non-cooperation. We all cooperate.
At the end of the summit, we are going to have resolutions. And some of these resolutions require certain commitments, say, of our budgets, to ensure that we fulfill those resolutions. Why isn't Uganda always in position to fulfill some of these resolutions after they have appended their signatures to these kinds of documents?
Like which one? I think Uganda has really done well in terms of meeting its obligation. But NAM is not a regional body. It's not like the African Union or EAC or IGAD where we pay membership fees. I think the resolutions will help us really have common positions on the group. That's the purpose behind NAM and G77. These resolutions are really like guiding principles and help us to coordinate and be cohesive so that we can have leverage on the international system that is really unfair, that is in favor of different countries. And you've seen the theme of our summit, NAM summit, deepening cooperation, you know, and shared prosperity, which means that you cannot have one side of the globe, you know, prospering at the expense of the other side of the globe. So there is benefits. Uganda really meets its obligation. I mean, look at how we have helped regional countries in terms of support, South Sudan, you know, training teachers, you know, exchanging experience. And that is South-South cooperation in action.
Okay. The NAM, as you just put it, had gains in the 1990s where they managed to deal with issues of decolonization. They were key in fighting apartheid in South Africa, down there, when the black people were being oppressed through those systems of apartheid. Going forward, do we expect to see a vocal NAM compared to what it has been in these last few years, from that time when we knew them, to be very vocal on issues, racism, issues of decolonization, like I just said?
I really miss that NAM as well. But the challenges are different now. I think, like I said, colonization is mostly done and independence by NAM countries. And that really called for different tactics and strategies, which were more vocal, even armed action. But now the challenge is really, how do you navigate the international system to develop our countries? That is the challenge. And that is sometimes not visible, boring to the common person, but when we really caucus together and we push common positions, that has impact. And that is different. Of course, sometimes it's not visible, but that really has impact. But people in my ecosystem, the diplomats, know how NAM, especially G77, is influential at the UN.
Well, His Excellency Ambassador Adonia Yebare, Uganda's permanent representative to the United Nations, has been telling us how Uganda will benefit from the NAM summit that is currently ongoing at the Munyonyo Speak Resort Hotel. And until next time, this has been this week's Checkpoint. I'm Vivian Kamsimi.